Power of the pen, which was certainly true in the case of Dr. Numbers. You have a program before you. The program will move unannounced, but I want to take a couple of moments just to orient you to who will be in the program and to one change. Regrettably, our music, due to a health condition, has had to change. Ednaldo Brasil, a clarinetist from La Sierra, we'll offer two numbers accompanied by Dr. Gail Rice on the piano. The second number will come right before the photographs. You will note that in your program. Eric Anderson will do a life sketch. Jonathan Butler will focus on Ron Number's contributions to Adventist history. And Ed Larson will discuss his career in the wider world of the history of science and medicine. Eric Anderson, I have a special affinity to of my alma mater back in Keene, Texas for about 10 years. And it was my privilege to spend some time with him during that time. Eric has a doctorate in history from the University of Chicago, an institution I understand that Ron Numbers always identified as a notorious diploma mill. Because of all the Adventists who had doctorates from there. Since 1975, Eric has served in a variety of positions at Pacific Union College, with detours to the National Endowments for the Humanities, 1984, a Fulbright Scholarship in Greece, 1992, and as I mentioned, the presidency of Southwestern Adventist University. Eric's research interests focus on African American history and Adventist history. Earlier this year, he presented the inaugural MacArthur Lecture at Southern Adventist University entitled Smashing Icons, Reflections on Thomas Jefferson and Others. Jonathan, or John Butler, also has a doctorate from that notorious diploma mill. Some things are hard to say with a straight face. The University of Chicago. He has taught both at Union College and La Sierra University. His field is American religious history with a special interest in Adventist history and Ellen White's life. He wrote an introduction to the second and third edition of Ron's Prophetess of Health entitled The Historian as Heretic, which discussed the fallout from what was then a controversial book. And finally, Ed Larson was a student of Ron Numbers at University of Wisconsin, and like his friends and mentor, is an incredibly productive scholar. He already had a law degree from Harvard when he completed his doctoral work at Wisconsin in 1984. Since then, he has 15 books on subjects ranging from evolution and exploration to eugenics and the leadership revolutionary area of America. He won the Pulitzer Prize for his 1998 book on the Scopes Trial, Summer of the Gods. His most recent work is American Inheritance, Liberty and Slavery in the Birth of a Nation, 1765 to 1795. An American historian and legal scholar, he's a university professor of history, and the darling chair of law at Pepperdine. In other words, he's as much in history as he is in law. As this program unfolds, you'll see the value of a life well lived, a life dedicated to the pursuit of knowledge, to the sharing of the work of research, and the impact, sometimes very challenging, but ultimately very good, that one life can have. So we're grateful to you for taking your time this afternoon to join on this very special occasion. The program will proceed as indicated and is in your bulletin.
The name Ronald L. Numbers rested quietly on the membership rolls of the Loma Linda University Church for four decades. After about 1974, he did not devote his Sabbath mornings to worship. Though he called himself an agnostic, he was, in a sense, a promoter of Seventh-day Adventism all his life. Unlike many other lapsed Adventists, he did not engage in a jihad against his former beliefs or seek to suppress his religious roots. Indeed, according to those who knew him best, He was a lifelong vegetarian whose feet never learned to dance. An old announcement of an Adventist evangelistic meeting decorated his study for many years. Ron was born into a deeply rooted Adventist family, the son of Pastor Raymond W. Numbers, a minister with missionary experience, and Lois Branson Numbers, daughter of William H. Branson, church administrator and author of a widely circulated defense of Ellen White. Indeed, when Ron reached the age of accountability, as Adventists describe the age of children suitable for baptism, his grandfather was president of the General Conference. A physics and mathematics graduate of Southern Missionary College in 1963, he switched to studying history in graduate school, earning a master's at Florida State and a 1969 doctorate at University of California, Berkeley. He remembered ruefully his struggles to become a writer, at first getting A's for his research, but D's for his style at Florida State. People who enjoy his masterful prose as a mature historian have a hard time believing that report, but it's true. As a graduate student, Ron was one of the founders of the Association of Adventist Forums, a self-consciously reformist organization made up in those days of young academics. AAF sponsored Spectrum magazine, a journal that would ultimately publish many of the most influential reinterpretations of Adventist history. Ron's first job was at Andrews University, a school then experiencing a flowering of Ellen White research, with William Peterson, Don McAdams, Roy Branson, and other young scholars raising questions about the Adventist prophet's historical context. The fledgling historian of science enjoyed cross-examining well-informed creationists such as Richard Ritland and Edward Lugenbeel at the church's Geoscience Research Institute, then located in Berrien Springs. His classes at Andrews were small but populated with argumentative honors students, eager to embrace subjects such as scientific change and Thomas Kuhn's Paradigms Lost. When he accepted an appointment at Loma Linda in 1970, he found himself teaching a lighter load, but striving to stimulate medical students for whom history of science was, a distinctly secondary concern. During his 4 years at Loma Linda, he was an assiduous researcher, producing manuscripts on topics ranging from Adventist health reform to theories of creation to government health insurance. After Loma Linda sent him packing in 1974 under a cloud of controversy, these manuscripts became academic publications for the scholar now establishing himself at the University of Wisconsin. Prophetess of Health, A Study of Ellen White, appeared in 1976. Creation by Natural Law, Laplace's Nebular Hypothesis, was published in 1977. And Almost Persuaded, American Physicians and Compulsory Health Insurance, 1912 to 1920, followed the next year. It would be hard to imagine a more auspicious beginning for a young historian. Yet for many Seventh-day Adventists, Numbers was a figure of controversy, even an outcast. His work on Ellen White circulated widely among Adventists before publication, and he was described by some readers as a mean-spirited debunker of the beloved Adventist leader. Several sentences in the preface were regularly cited and misinterpreted by official defenders. Affirming his commitment to scholarly objectivity, Numbers wrote, "I have refrained from using divine inspiration as an historical explanation." Today, even scholars who affirm Ellen White's authority can and do endorse this statement of methodology. He bluntly added that judgments about Ellen White's integrity were more properly conclusions than presuppositions, an observation that was logically irrefutable. The notion that Numbers was on the warpath against Adventism or religion in general is undermined by the direction of his later research. In his teaching and writing, he repeatedly challenged the 19th century military metaphor, which asserted that religion and science were inevitably at war. The greatest myth in the history of science and religion holds that they have been in a state of constant conflict, he declared near the end of his career. It was a theme he repeated and clarified with great rigor and evidence in 40 books he wrote and edited, most notably in God and Nature, Historical Essays on the Encounter Between Christianity and Science, Darwin Comes to America, Science and Christianity in the Pulpit and Pew, and the 8-volume Cambridge History of Science, which he co-edited. Numbers did not stay mired in controversy over Prophetess of Health, though he did bear scars and could always be prompted to share war stories of the 1970s. But he kept finding new and significant aspects of Adventist history. His award-winning book, The Creationists, The Evolution of Scientific Creationism, showed the neglected impact of Ellen White's ideas on critics of Darwin. Although I no longer believe in creationism of any kind, he wrote, I'm strongly committed to treating its advocates with the same respect I might accord to evolutionists. This surprised some readers and earned him invitations to speak at several Adventist campuses and other evangelical campuses, I might add. His final research project, unfortunately never finished, was another study with deep Seventh-day Adventist implications, a biography of John Harvey Kellogg, promised to Harvard University Press. From 1972, when Ron and his friend Vern Carner helped organize a series of lectures at this church on Adventist history, to 1984, when he led a conference on Millerism in Killington, Vermont, to the 2009 conference in Portland, Maine, that eventually resulted in the influential book, Ellen Harmon White, Numbers devoted great energy to Adventist themes. He relished the result of his labors. The elevation of Ellen White, as he put it, from a virtually unknown historical actor to a minor star on the stage of American religious history. He never cut off diplomatic relations with his Adventist colleagues, even during the awkward years immediately after the publication of Prophetess of Health. In 1979, the president of the Association of Western Adventist Historians told his colleagues, even if you never deliver a single lecture on denominational history, numbers and other contextualizers have run interference for you, making it safe to move beyond interpretations of the past, which were once inseparable from Adventism. The next year, Numbers accepted an invitation to attend the annual meeting of the association at Walla Walla. His colleagues eventually stopped wishing that his famous chapter on short skirts and sex had been more pedantically entitled, something like The Reform Dress and Theories of Vital Force. Even the most traditional among them recognized that future treatments of Ellen White and health would have to accept that she was not inerrant nor entirely original. And we needed to be very careful with sweeping claims about Ellen White being 100 years ahead of her time. A master teacher and mentor, Numbers regularly encouraged his friends who taught in Adventist schools, suggesting promising research subjects, making strategic introductions, and creating opportunities for publication. He was always ready to critique their work and offer thoughtful editorial suggestions. By the end of his life, few Adventist scholars saw him as a threat. A few months before Numbers died, a representative of the North American Division telephoned to apologize on behalf of the denomination for what football referees might call the unnecessary roughness of certain actions in the 1970s. No one objected when Andrews University accepted the donation of his academic papers and his extensive library. Numbers had gone from persona non grata to honored philanthropist. Numbers never mellowed into a mild grandfatherly presence, however. In the language of 19th century phrenology, his skull lacked a large bump of reverence. He remained blunt, witty, acerbic, a man who certainly did not suffer fools gladly. Woe to the scholar whom he judged unserious, not up to his high standards. Over a long scholarly career, he was recognized in almost every way he could have hoped for as a young man. When he left Berkeley, he might have dreamed of a named chair at one of the world's leading universities, a Guggenheim Fellowship, and countless laudatory reviews of his work. He could have possibly imagined editing ISIS, the leading journal in the history of science and medicine. But he probably never even fantasized about serving almost simultaneously as president of both the History of Science Society and the American Society of Church History. Better than every other accolade, perhaps, was the belated approval of his father. "I may never agree with you on everything, Ronnie, but I know now you did honest work." Among his more academic recognitions, nothing matched an enthusiastic review of The Creationists, an assessment that is worth quoting in some detail. One historian of science proposed that the Executive Council of the American Scientific Affiliation should limit ASA membership to those signing a statement that they have read the book from cover to cover. On second thought, he intensified his praise. Maybe prospective members should be required to pass a test demonstrating they've read the book with comprehension. No, wait, even better, he said. No one, ASA member or not, should be allowed to say anything in the creation evolution debate without presenting a signed affidavit attesting to the thoughtful completion of Professor Numbers' painstaking study. Whew. I had to double check the author's name to make sure that Mark Kaltoff of Hillsdale College was not a secret pen name for Ronald L. Numbers. If he could be here today, Ron would be deeply distressed if anyone got the idea that in his last days he had a deathbed conversion, recanting the work of a lifetime. He would say, "Oh yes, there's an apocryphal story like that about Darwin." But it would be truthful to say, to the end, he retained great affection for his roots and his family. Indeed, his daughter and granddaughter were more important to him, he said, than all his scholarly achievements. As he faded away from a long, debilitating illness, Ron and his daughter Leslie prepared a musical playlist for this once stout and feisty man, at last confined to his bed. What he wanted to hear most was Southern gospel music, songs like "Just a Closer Walk with Thee," sung by Patsy Cline, "Will the Circle Be Unbroken" by the Carter family, or "Amazing Grace" in Willie Nelson's nasal twang. As I try to envision my friend's last hours, I'm almost overwhelmed. I think of Ron listening to another song on his list of favorites. "Oh, they tell me of a home far beyond the skies. Oh, they tell me of a home far away. Oh, they tell me of a home where no storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of an unclouded day." The music lingers in my mind. I can only add, rest in peace, old friend.
74.
Ronald Numbers arrived at Loma Linda University in 1970, a fledgling professor at 28. The dean of the medical school, David Henshaw, made an impractical request of him. He asked Ron to teach a graduate level course to medical students on the history of science and medicine. In spite of the crushing demands of their medical studies, the students would be required to attend Ron's lectures, read a scholarly book a week, write book reviews, and do a major term paper. What sounded good to the dean did not sound so good to the students. In fact, on the very first day of class, an overworked medical student with a look of despair asked Ron if he could speak to the class. The student held up a petition for his classmates to sign. It requested that the class be canceled. As a result, it soon was. Dean Henshaw then turned to Plan B. He asked Ron instead to do a lecture-only class on the history of Adventist health and medicine. The average professor might have prepared for such a class by reading Doris Robinson's The Story of Our Health Message and placing it in its historical context. However, there was nothing average about Ron Numbers. He soon wandered into the Loma Linda Medical Library. He asked about a metal cage he saw with books and documents locked away in it. In that collection, he came across a book by well-known health reformer Larkin B. Coles. In the margins of the book, Ron saw shorthand notations which looked to him like John Kellogg's writing. He got help deciphering the shorthand, then traced the Kellogg references to Ellen White's book, Christian Temperance and Bible Hygiene. Ron found that some 75 years earlier, Kellogg had uncovered Ellen White's literary dependence on Larkin Coles. More than a set of lectures came from Ron's discovery or rediscovery. The book Prophetess of Health was born. Many of us here today recall that book created quite a furor. Adventists had never seen a book quite like it. The boy from Southern Missionary College had gone on to UC Berkeley, where he had learned to write as an accomplished historian. Up to that point, Adventist historians had written about Ellen White gently and reverently, as standing high on a pedestal without clay feet. Ron wrote about her as if she were any other historical figure, as he would have written about Harriet Beecher Stowe or Mary Todd Lincoln or Susan B. Anthony. In Prophetess of Health, Ron saw Ellen White as a flawed and imperfect human being. He saw that she had been influenced by her surroundings in good ways and not so good. She was a woman of her times, a product of her cultural setting. This created quite a firestorm. Ron stood shoulder to shoulder with the new crop of Adventist historians who arrived on college campuses in the 1970s. Young, talented, and well-educated, they all understood the writing of history in the same way. But there was one big difference between them. Ron practiced his historical craft on Ellen White herself. Most of the other historians did not. Perhaps for them, it was too risky professionally within the church. Perhaps for them, it was too parochial beyond the church. Perhaps for them, Ellen White should be left to pastors or theologians. But Ron changed all that. What he did, and he was the first to do so, was write a full-fledged historical biography of Ellen White, which placed the Adventist prophet alongside other faces in history where she belongs. After his discovery in the metal cage in the library, Ron was still reluctant to publish the book about Ellen White. He thought there would be too little interest in it. Fortunately, his best friend, Vern Carner, strongly encouraged him. Vern believed that Ron was sitting on a great story, and he was just the one to tell it. Ron and Vern were inseparable at Loma Linda. Ron, the academic writer, and Vern, his agent and promoter. They formed the ideal tandem to get a lot done. Vern was pleased when Ron did show that Ellen White's story was worth telling, and Harper and Row wanted to publish it, and Time magazine wanted to report on it, and the University of Wisconsin wanted to hire him for doing it. Ron Numbers had introduced a relatively unknown woman to the world. Ron knew his book was controversial, and he expected blowback from the church. He was dismayed, however, when his fellow historians failed to support him. He felt abandoned and betrayed. He had done his best to build capital with the church. There were so many examples of this. The university church, celebrating his life today as an historian, sponsored a lecture series on the roots of Adventism. Ron and Vern organized the event and invited prominent non-Adventist historians to the church. They lectured on the world in which Adventism came into existence. The book, The Rise of Adventism, published by Harper and Row, is an enduring monument to that special event in this church. Ron was also the founding editor of Adventist Heritage, a popular magazine on Adventist history. When Prophets of Health exploded, all the capital Ron had earned quickly dissipated. It was a dark period for him. He had done so well, but it was not good enough for the church or his historian friends within the church. The Adventist Heritage Board threw him off the magazine he had founded. I knew firsthand how upset he was. I was on the board that dumped him, and he blamed me. We were close friends by then, but he still thought I was at fault. I explained to him that I was at Lincoln, Nebraska when the board met, not in Loma Linda, but he wasn't buying it. Once we were in Walla Walla together for history meetings, and I was driving and he was in the back seat, and we were quarreling again about Adventist Heritage. I slowed down every time I was talking and sped up every time he talked. A cop pulled me over, but that's not the end of the story. Ron graciously paid half of my ticket, which says a lot about him. We could not have been closer friends when I wrote the essay Historian is Heretic, which became the introduction to Prophetess of Health. It dealt with the fallout over the book 15 years earlier. I met Ron in Colorado Springs, and for several days we talked about that turbulent, distressing time. We walked the streets into the night and ate dinner where the students hung out. Ron was especially unhappy with the amateur psychobiography written about him. Critics had said he came from an inflexibly fundamentalist background, and that explained his view of Ellen White. Ron disagreed. He adored his grandfather, the GC president, W.H. Branson, who spent time playing with his grandson, talking to him man to man, and even taking him to the movies. How many of us here today had a GC president for a grandfather who took us to the movies? Ron's father took the criticism of Ron the hardest. He asked him, "Was I unreasonable as a parent in the way I raised you?" Ron told his father, "No, you were a great dad and far more reasonable than any of my friends' parents." As we talked, Ron remembered an inside article I had written about my own dad. I had done it in a kindly way. Ron said, when you write about me, promise you'll take care of my dad in the same way you did yours in Insight. Father and son had disagreed on spiritual matters. But there was no personal animosity between them, only mutual affection and respect. What took time for the church and its historians to realize was that Ron Numbers had brought something new to Adventism, a new kind of history. He was no D.M. Canwright, writing an expose on Ellen White and devoting himself for the rest of his life to declaring her a fraud and trashing his tradition. When he was at Loma Linda, he wanted to become an historian. He wrote 3 books in the 4 years he was here, scores of edited books later, countless articles in a period of 40 years. Ron was all about building a career, not tearing down a church. The historians began to realize this when Gary Land, a colleague of Ron's at Andrews, wrote a review of the White Estate Critique of Prophetess of Health. Land showed that White Estate staffers believed, in effect, in Ellen White's infallibility. They rejected Ron's book because it pointed out where they were wrong. The historians saw Land's point and began coming around. Not overnight and not all at once, but the historians and many of the church at large began to see the light, the new light. Fortunately, Ron, from the vantage point of a named chair at the University of Wisconsin, got to see it happen. Spectrum magazine, for its 25th anniversary issue, declared Ron Numbers one of the 5 most influential Adventists in the last quarter century. Ben MacArthur, an historian at Ron's alma mater, Southern Adventist University, declared Prophetess of Health the most important book on Adventism in 40 years. When Ron left Loma Linda, in a way he left home. He became one of the most prominent historians of science and medicine in his generation. He became an academic celebrity. Yet he never forgot his roots, never got so far from home that he lost contact with his old friends in the Adventist community. A few years ago, I wrote about Ron's ongoing relationship to SDAs and published it in a non-SDA journal, Church History. I suggested that, in a sense, a part of him had never left Adventism behind. I cited a hit song from the popular band The Eagles, Hotel California. For Ron, the church was a little like Hotel California, where you can check out anytime you like, but you can never leave. Before I sent in the article, I showed it to Ron as I showed him everything I wrote on Adventism. I said to him, I'm not sure you'll want me to put in that Eagles line. And he said, no, I do want you to. Leave it in. That told me my hunch was right. A part of him had never left, never could leave. All the books on Adventism that he published after he left Loma Linda proved the point. Among Adventists, he was always the best known for Prophetess of Health, but in the world beyond Adventism, he is even better known for the creationists. Prophetess of Health put Ellen White on the map as a health reformer. The creationists let the world know how important she was for scientific creationism and intelligent design. At a History of Science meeting in San Francisco, Ron flashed a photo of Ellen White onto a wide screen. He asked his academic audience if they knew who she was. No one did. He then told them that there's no explaining the creationist movement without her. She's its founding mother. Ron edited two major works on Adventist history, one, The Disappointed, on Millerism and Millenarianism in the 19th century, the other, Ellen Harmon White, American Prophet. In both cases, so typical of Ron, they were collaborations. He co-organized the conferences that produced the books, co-edited the books, and he found the publishers. In 1984, the Millerite Conference met in Killington, Vermont, near William Miller's farm. In 2009, the Ellen White Conference met in Portland, Maine, the prophet's hometown. At any conference on Adventist history, Ron wanted non-SDAs meeting with the SDAs. In his mind, the best way to understand Adventists was to invite non-Adventists in on the discussion. At the Portland meetings, it was kind of interesting. It was the non-Adventists who often said the most positive things about Ellen White. They talked like excited miners who had stumbled onto gold. They exclaimed over Ellen White's value to religion, to women, to culture and society. The non-Adventist women found her particularly valuable and admirable as a resource. In the evenings, Ron sat around with the participants and held court. He was done with academics for the day. He wanted to talk with people personally, to draw them out about their own backgrounds, their own life journeys. The book Ellen Harmon White, American Prophet, came from that sort of conference, that sort of personal chemistry, which Ron was so good at creating. The book is a brainchild of four scholars, Julius Naum, to whom the book is dedicated, and Terry Amott, Gary Land, and Ron Numbers, the three who co-edited the book. They needed Ron for his academic rigor, his experience, his connections to other academics, and for help in finding a publisher. He was the key to producing a state-of-the-art book on Ellen White. He's the reason Julius Naum flew from Washington, D.C. yesterday on his way to South Korea tonight to honor Ron. It's the reason Terry Amott flew from Walla Walla as the last of the three editors still with us to honor Ron. At the Portland, Maine conference, Grant Wacker, the renowned professor of religion from Duke University, spoke of Ron's importance to Adventist history. You've seen it on the back of the program. In the history of every religious community, there's that watershed historian who marks the before and after of how its history is written. For Pentecostalism, it is Robert Mapes Anderson. For Mormonism, it is Richard Bushman. For Seventh-day Adventism, it is Ronald Numbers. When I reflect on Ron's life, however, I think less about the magnificent accomplishments of his career. I remember instead all he did for others. A generation of Adventist scholars know him for his generosity, his willingness to read and critique everything they sent him, the way he found a place for them in his own projects, the connections he made for them, his help finding a publisher, the new friends to whom he introduced them in a wider scholarly world. I look back on my own modest achievements as a scholar and realize that every good thing I did has his fingerprints on it. So many of us as Adventist historians are indebted in this way to Ron. To write history now without his help is to walk the high wire without a net below. It's to look down and no longer see his broad face and impish grin as he coaxes you to take the next step. We will certainly miss him.
Eric and John, thank you very much for what you've said. Let me preface my remarks with two quick points. First, Ron would want everyone to know here that the Badger Wisconsin football team won today. Next to his family, that was the most important thing in his life, best I could tell. Second, I know that it is now 3 minutes of five, and this was supposed to end at five. And I'm the only thing standing between you and a light supper. So I will try to edit my remarks as I go. We've already heard so much from Eric and John that tell us about Ron as a scholar, as a historian, as a historian of science, as a historian of medicine, and as a historian of religion, because he was all of those things. Ron once told me that for a scholar, his PhD major professor was the closest relationship to that of a second father. Now, back then, of course, most major professors were men, but I suspect Ron would still say whether that major professor was a man or a woman, she was the closest thing to a second father you'd have. I don't think that part would have changed. And so, I have a personal relationship, a different sort than Eric and John have had. I first met Ron, Professor Numbers, then, of course, when I returned to the University of Wisconsin in 1982 to finish my PhD in the history of science. I already had my master's. I'd done much of my work already. He had been there in the mid-1970s when I earned my MA in the field, but I had not known of him then. After, and we've heard the story, after him being exiled from Loma Linda College for having, in a sense, lost his Adventist religious faith, though I agree with both of you that he never totally lost the Adventist relationship, and for documenting the reasons for this loss of faith, Ron found refuge, as we've heard, at the University of Wisconsin, in some sort of position at first that because of his excellence evolved. It wasn't there originally, to a tenure track and then a tenure and then ultimately as a chaired professorship. Ron had achieved tenure at Wisconsin by the time I showed up the second time. My intended major professor, the one I was coming back to study with, Bill Coleman had died by that point. Ron eventually named his own chair after Bill Coleman. With that of having happened, I ended up studying under Ron, and he refocused my studies from the history of 19th century evolutionism, which was Bill's specialty, to 20th century creationism. Now, I had always read, and I'll confess here, I had always read the biblical account of creation as ancient fables that perhaps carried moral meaning, but which no educated modern American could accept as literalistically true. Ron saw creationist accounts quite differently. He had taken them literally for most of his life, and he knew many educated modern Americans who still did. Those accounts shaped their worldview. These people and their beliefs served as the focus of Ron's research at the time, and he drew me into it. The one thing, and we've heard this from both Eric and John, the one thing he always maintained was respect for those creationists. Empathy as well, I would add. Well, having returned to Madison with Ron as my major professor, I had to make up for not having known him and studied under him by taking two courses from him in the history of American science, which technically was his specialty. Despite all we've heard about, as Ron is a religious historian and as a historian of medicine, at Madison he was technically the historian of American science. Now, having done that, I said two courses. First came an undergraduate course with a graduate student component. The second came in a graduate seminar. Now, at the time, and I'm sure Janet would remember this, many graduate students feared Ron's rigor. So while about 20 undergraduate innocents took the first course, who had no idea what they were getting into, only a couple graduate students signed up for either of them. With the seminar in particular, which was limited grad students, involving myself and one other student, and Ron. And Ron decided we'd meet once a week over breakfast at a booth in a local diner. Now, Ron was a voracious and discerning reader who critically consumed virtually every scholarly book or article in his field. I only knew one other professor who was that compulsive. It showed in his teaching. He assigned a stack, literally it's a box full, a stack of photocopied articles from various scholars for the undergraduate course, and a stack, just like you described when he first came here and the students revolted, a stack of leading monographs, one a week, for the graduate course. Classes consisted of discussing those readings. I never knew if Ron ever prepared for class. Certainly, unlike his closest friend and collaborator at Madison, Dave Lindberg, Ron never lectured. If Dave's class were akin to a Baptist church service with a polished preaching, Ron's were like a Quaker meeting with information bubbling up from student comments facilitated by the instructor. While Dave formally tested his students' learning with carefully crafted written exams, Ron informally gauged it with oral student interviews. Students could work hours in taking Dave's final exams. Ron, in contrast, Ron's finals would consist of a 15-minute office meeting. He'd have the students come in one at a time, and he'd talk with them. In the end, however, Ron likely gained a better understanding, because he was such a good questioner, a better understanding than Dave of how much each student actually knew about the subject. And it saved him time in grading. I never knew which of those objectives motivated Ron. I never equaled Ron as a critical reader of scholarship in our field, and I never fully adopted his informal teaching style. His academic rigor, though, and intellectual integrity became my guiding principles. In those ways, Ron remains my mentor and the mentor of so many people in the profession. We've heard about that in his influence on Adventist scholars. So with that personal story about his teaching and his scholarship, let me try to summarize how I view his impact on the profession beyond Adventism. And I think it falls into three basic camps. First, as a researcher and writer. Second, as a conference organizer and editor of work, and finally, as a exemplary, just a simply exemplary professional colleague and leader, intellectual leader. So let me quickly talk about those things. To go in Ron's study would be to overwhelm with research materials. When Ron wrote a book, he mostly conducted research. I think that's probably why the Kellogg book hasn't come out or the History of American Science book has come out, but we see that in his creationist book. He collected research materials far and wide. Now, he liked to travel anyway, as some of you may know, and so the traveling could combine with the researching, but he was a meticulous researcher, and he would gather those materials, and they would fill any room, and I visited many of his homes and many of his offices, and they were filled with research materials, and the issue became digesting those down into a published form, an article or a book. The creationist, as you would mention, has become by far the most impactful of those monographs that Ron produced. Within your church, I'm sure the Prophetess of Health, but if I'm talking about the history of science and the history of religion, it's the creationist book, which won the prize that year of the Society of Church Historians. It, most of all, was a phenomenal work of research. He tracked down everyone. He talked to everyone. When I was later working on my own dissertation with him, everyone that I ended up tracing had already talked to Ron. He had their materials, and the challenge for him became digesting it into a readable book. I can see he grew beyond his story at Florida State, but I love the story at Florida State because I think there was truth to where he came from in that. But it was because he documented these issues so thoroughly that every side could accept his work on a controversial subject like the creationists. Both the creationists, the leading creationist, and I met with them, respected him. The leading evolutionists did as well. That was a tribute to his research and his integrity. He was not making fun of the creationist. He was explaining them, understanding them, and they respected what he found there. Now, second, I said I'd try to speed up, so it's hard to because his levels were so important. So there was an important area. But we can't forget Ron as an editor and a conference leader. Ron had this winning way about him that he could get people together for a conference, he could get funding for that conference, he could hold that conference in some interesting place, and he could browbeat the people at the conference into producing a paper. And he would keep sending it back until he gave up on that person and rewrote it himself, which he often did. Because any publication in his edited books had to be up to the standard of Ron and Dave Lindberg, because the first ones were always co-edited. And Dave Lindberg, also out of a church tradition, but who held to his religious faith much longer and was still quite active in the church when I was at Madison. They had the highest standard of the scholarship. And interestingly, no matter what topic they were writing on, Ron probably knew more about the underlying research material than they did. So he could direct them to fill in the gaps, and if they didn't, he did. And that's why his books like Science, make sure I get the name right, the first book he did with A God in Nature, why that book had such a tremendous impact on the profession, because it pulled together all the finest scholars and produced readable articles to him because Ron, even more than Dave, was a gifted editor. That's why he became editor of ISIS, and he brought that same skills to ISIS. If he whatever his own skills as a writer, he knew good writing, and he knew how to bring it out of others. Finally, in the area of professional leadership, not only was he in all the organizations, not only was he active in them, not only did he meet with people, you talk about what he did with Adventists, young Adventist scholars. He did this at history of science meetings, church history meetings, American history meetings. He would network, he would work with these people, he'd be willing to read all their work, and he read it well because he knew the underlying literature as well as anyone in America, and he would direct them forward. So he was helping lots of people. He helped me tremendously on my own dissertation, but he was helping people all over America, and they recognized that by making him a leader in organizations. He was a founder, co-founder, one of the founding members of the International Society for Science and Religion. He moved on to the boards of the History of Science Society, American History Associations, Church History Associations, the International Society of Science, and for many of them, he rose to the presidency. That is a tribute to how he worked with people. And, you know, those things make a difference to the profession. Those conferences and the papers that were brought out for him that were read, those books he wrote himself, those graduate students that he mentored, and there were many of them who are scattered all over the country, and finally, all those people he worked with in the tireless work of being a leader of professional societies, they changed our view. They added respect for religion. In the story of science and religion, religion was no longer the comical part and science the serious part. They were both, in his view, of equal dignity. And he brought that to the profession, and he changed the way the profession was because of all those things. Now, because of the time, I could go off on all of these, but you've heard so much. I wanted to close with something that I'm recycling a bit, but it applies so well with Ron, in my opinion. Like all performers, those who write history for an audience do so that will interest, enlighten, move, educate, and maybe even entertain readers. Second, to help create, out of silence and solitude, a community or communities of people drawn to this information and those narratives. And think of how Ron has brought people to the question, serious study of the creationist, the study of Adventist history, the study of religious history, the study of, in the history of science and religion, changing it from a conflict narrative, being an important person in changing it from a conflict narrative, along with Dave Lindberg and a few others, into the what's known as the as a theory where it is called the complexity theory, where there is a complex relationship, sometimes conflict, but sometimes cooperation, sometimes tensions, sometimes creative tensions, sometimes destructive tensions, all those things. That is now the dominant view. And recently I read a major book published by a major publisher and by an English scholar who talked about this change and dropped a footnote and said there are 10 people involved in this change. 10 historians who caused it, and Dave Lindberg and Ron Numbers were the first two. I came in number 6. And finally, the last thing I'd say about these people who write this, usually at an unconscious level, and this has been alluded to gain for the writer, to gain for ourselves, attention and admiration from strangers. Generally, as anonymous stand-ins, for parents who we think, in one way or another, fail to recognize adequately our specialness. Ron was special, and he talked to me often about his father. He did receive this admiration and finally it spread off to his family, and it's testified to here with his church family as well. Thank you very much, and I won't stand in the way of dinner.
Let's have the music during the showing of the pictures. And so move so that you're not going to block the screen. Now, don't worry, the pictures only last four and a half minutes. But as you start to see Ron Numbers from his baby picture and his standing with his classmates at the Chattanooga Junior Academy, you're going to say to yourself, how in the world did he ever come from there to here? And you won't recognize all the people in the pictures, but there's somebody here who will recognize all of them. And the pictures themselves are an amazing story of his life. You'll see my favorite picture of all these pictures. He has one crew cut picture where he's sort of standing like this with a swagger to him. You'll enjoy this. Let me show you the picture. Oh, one thing. My friends didn't tell the most interesting anecdote. I was at the White Estate, and Numbers was at Hopkins, and I was studying at Hopkins. And so I would stay with him in the evenings once a week. And it got very awkward because I was defending Ellen White. I was complaining about the tensions that I was suffering. And Judy Rittenhouse Dibdahl, she said, "Well, don't worry. Two Rons don't make a White." Thank you.
We want to thank you for coming, for spending this time honoring Dr. Ronald Numbers. We want to invite you to remain, to partake of some of the treats in the back, and also to interact with one another and share stories and tears and no doubt laughter as well with his wife and beloved daughter. I dismiss you with the words of the Aaronic blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen.